gets me excited. So let's start. So blessing and curses, an empty tomb. And I think just a good understanding of the empty tomb is it's very crucial for really being a Christian. That is the only thing we actually hold to fast. Because if he did not rise, neither of us are saved. Paul said that everything is made void. So it's by the power of the resurrection that we have achieved our salvation. I want us to turn to Romans 8:1. It says, "There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus." So I wanted us to look at something. I'm not going to read it completely. It's from Numbers 23 through 24. It's talking about Balaam and Balak. And Balak was sent to curse the Israelites, to curse the Jewish people. And he actually tried to go out and curse these people three times. And God actually withheld his curses and made him bless the people. And I found that really interesting that God, with what he does and how he views his people, he does not want us to be cursed. He actually took the curse for us, and that we actually receive blessing and we have the opportunity to bless back. So the first thing, going right to it, we are actually changed, and he sympathizes from that empty grave. Psalms 40:4-5 says, "Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not turn to the proud, to those who go astray after a lie. You have multiplied, O Lord, my God, your wondrous deeds and your thoughts towards us. None can compare with you. I will proclaim and tell them, yet they are more than can be told." So I kind of jumped the gun a little bit, but to bless is to give words of life that nourish the soul and deepens its desire for truth. The significance of the crucifixion is for God's people that every scar, every wound, every emotion that was experienced was and is for our gain, and for him to sympathize authentically with our weaknesses. So Psalm 22, I'm not going to read the whole thing. It's very related to what he went through at the cross. And we're going to step right into it. So, betrayal. Betrayal is a direct strike against trust. It tears relationships to shreds if not engaged with a desire of redemption for both parties. Why was the betrayal of Judas's kiss such a blow to the disciples and Jesus? Anybody have a clue? I know, I kind of cheated. I gave you. So I kind of took after your class, and a holy kiss, it's showing intimacy, it's showing closeness and relationship. And the reason why it was such a blow was that was like family to Jesus. Even though Jesus declared, he said that, "I know you're going to do this." And just to know that he would come in such intimacy to do it was such a powerful message. So we see that betrayals happen in many ways: unfaithfulness, lying, adultery, fornication, hate, even in wrath. And I wanted us to turn to Romans 16:16. It says, "Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the churches of Christ greet you." Another says, "All the brothers send you greetings." This is from 1 Corinthians 16:20. "Greet one another with a holy kiss." So we see there's a reason. It's a bond. It's to say, hey, we are of one spirit. And this is from Luke 22:47-48. This is the telling from the Bible. It says, "While he was still speaking, there came a crowd, and a man called Judas, one of the 12, was leading them. He drew near to Jesus to kiss him, but Jesus said to him, 'Judas, would you betray the Son of Man with a kiss? Luke 22, 47 through 48. And 1 Corinthians 11, 23 through 27 says, "For I have received from the Lord what I have also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty concerning the body and the blood of the Lord." So isolation. The reason I'm bringing this is because we face these things on a daily and a yearly process, and we should understand, hopefully this is something that I've learned, is that God doesn't just leave you alone in those feelings and those hurts and those injuries that we're saying God can't understand. He is actually present with us, and he sympathizes with our pains. And that's why he says that we should come before him with all of our cares, casting all of our cares on him, for he cares for us. So isolation, as it says, one of the most relatable in the human condition, the most devastating positions to be in. You can be physically be alone, or you can be constantly surrounded by people and still be affected and suffer this state of mind. So Genesis 2:18. This is when Adam was actually alone. He named all the animals, and it said that God noticed that man was alone, and he said that man should not be alone. And hear this from Matthew 27:45-46. It says, Jesus said, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani?" That is, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And in Psalm 22, it says, my God, why have you forsaken me?" That was in relation to that verse. "Why are you so far from saving me from the words of my groaning? Oh God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but I find no rest." And I was thinking about this. He also said to his people, he said, "Be strong and be courageous, for I will never leave you nor forsake you." And I think that's something that we often, when we get into circumstances, we really step out of bounds with and say, "God is not with me. I'm going through this alone. Why is he such a silent teacher?" And the hard thing to understand is even teachers will be silent when you're taking the test, taking the tribulation, taking your trial. But he still cares for you. He still wants to hear from you. And it's so easy for us to almost isolate ourselves from God in those moments. The reason I bring this up is in apologetics. The scripture is actually really important. This is something that I really walk to, of that as much as we look at everything that we see in the outside world, the science, the history, as Dave stated, the scripture is our foundation. And all these things that Jesus faced, he actually took it on our account. So, rejection. Rejection can be defined as the act of pushing someone or something away. One may experience rejection from one's families of origin, a friend, or a romantic partner, and the resulting emotions can often be painful. Rejection can be experienced on a large scale or in a small ways in everyday life. While rejection is typically a part of life, some types of rejection may be more difficult to cope with than others. So rejection can occur in a variety of circumstances. Typically, rejection describes an instance of a person, entity, pushing something away or someone away or out. A person may reject or refuse to accept a gift, for example, feelings of shame, sadness, or grief people feel when they are not accepted by others. A person might feel rejected after a significant I'm not going to read that all because we got a lot to go on. I'm sorry. So in Psalms 118, 22 through 24, it says, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing. It is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. It says, he was despised and rejected by man, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief, as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised. We esteemed him not. Surely he was born of our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken and smitten by God and afflicted. Isaiah 53:3-4. So accusations is prevalent in the world again. It can thrive in a church. This spreads through gossip, through holier-than-that person attitude. Causes much division in churches, creates sides, friends, and enemies, ends relationships. Jesus spoke about this in saying, not to judge too quickly, nor before examining your own heart and intent before judging. So, in Deuteronomy, it says that a single witness shall not suffice against a person for any crime or any wrongdoing in connection with any offense that he has committed. Only the evidence of two witnesses or three witnesses shall charge be established. If malicious witness arises to accuse a person of wrongdoing, then both parties to the dispute shall appear before the judges, shall inquire diligently. And if the witness is a false witness, he has accused his brother falsely, then you shall do to him as he meant to do to his brother. So you shall purge the evil from your midst, and the rest shall hear and fear, and shall never again commit any such evil among you. Your eye shall not pity. It shall be life for life, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, hand for hand, and foot for foot. This is from Zechariah 3:1-5. I'm sure we have heard this story. This is where Joshua stood before God in a vision. And it said that, then he showed me Joshua, the high priest, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to accuse him. And the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, O Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is not this brand a brand plucked from the fire? Now Joshua is standing before the angel, clothed with filthy garments. And the angel said to those who were standing before him, remove the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, behold, I have taken your iniquity away from you, and I will clothe you with pure vestments. And I said, let them put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head and clothed him with garments, and the angel of the Lord was standing by. Isaiah, so we'll continue on. Sorry, I know this might be boring, but I find this fascinating, that we can actually look to Scripture and how it correlates with what he faced at the cross. This is from Isaiah 53:5. It says, but he was pierced for our transgression, he was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace, and with his wounds we are healed. So healing is found because of his stripes that he took. Healing being emotional, being spiritual, and being physical. We are naturally broken in this world. Because of him, we are made new in his giving of himself to be broken. Jesus said, I did not come for the ones who view themselves as healthy. Rather, I came for the sick, the broken. He came as the great physician. So I'm not, if you guys want to record all that, those are verses that correlate really well. I want us to look at James 5:16. It says, therefore, confess your sins to one another, pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. And then 1 Peter 2:24 says, he himself bore our sins in his body on the tree that we might die to sin and live to righteousness. By his wounds you have been healed. For you were straying like sheep, but have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your souls. Then we look on to the crown of thorns. So he received the crown of thorns, and we were given crowns of royalty. Once again, we are born under the curse, needing saving, and receive much more. He removed his glory, coming as the lowliest, and made us part of the royal family of God, fellow heirs with Jesus, whose shame on earth imparts his glory, righteousness, and majesty on us. So this is from Genesis 3:17 through 19. It says, because you have listened to the voice of your wife and eaten of the tree of which I've commanded you, you shall not eat of it. Cursed is the ground because of you. In pain you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Thorns and thistles it shall bring forth, and you shall eat the plants of the field. By the sweat of your face you shall eat the bread till you return to the ground, for out of it you were taken. For you are dust, and to dust you shall return. Again, we could see a lot of scripture is being used here as a reminder of the curse and when he went to the cross. So the cross was known to be a place of shame, a place of being an example to others, a tormenting place, and a cursed place. The cross was 5 to 6 feet high, meaning that he was face to face with his mockers. Through this, we have found salvation and freedom under God's authority. Our curse is taken. Our blessings are given. Again, if you want to record verses and look them up. How about the sour wine? The sour wine was referenced for generational sin, that my parents struggled with this or that they enjoyed this, so I am bound to do it. I want us to look at Jeremiah 31:29. If you would. It says, in those days they shall no longer say, the fathers have eaten the sour grapes, and the children's teeth are set on edge. A lot of us know that Jeremiah 31 is talking about that new covenant, that we are actually taken out of the old covenant, where that generational sin was important, because God actually said it in Numbers. He said that it will follow your generations. And instead, God gives us a new covenant where he says, your father's sins, your forefather's sins, they are not your sins. That you are actually removed if you are in Christ. How about this one out of Ezekiel 18:14-17. And I'd love you guys to read Ezekiel 18. I think it's a really amazing scripture. It says, now suppose this man fathers a son who sees all the sins of that his father has done. He sees and does not do likewise. He does not eat upon the mountains or lift his eyes to the idols, to the house of Israel. Does not defile his neighbor's wife. Does not oppress anyone. Exacts no pledge. Commits no robbery, but gives his bread to the hungry and covers the naked with a garment. Withholds his hand from iniquity, takes no interest of profit, obeys the rules, and walks in my statutes. He shall not die for his father's iniquity. He shall surely live. Here's another one, actually, out of Jeremiah 31:34, actually. It says, and no longer shall each teach his neighbor and each his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they all shall know me, for the least of them to the greatest, declares the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity and I will remember their sin no more. Jeremiah 31:34. So the scriptures on the wound on his side. Again, I will let you guys, if you guys are interested, to look at that. I think, again, these verses are really powerful if you let them just permeate in your mind and in your heart. So the evidences of the empty tomb. I knew you guys were waiting for this one. All right, so the first thing, the Roman soldiers were posted at the entrance, stone covering the opening. So second, if you're recording, the first witnesses of the empty tomb. The third, the disciples returned to the tomb. Four, the shroud of Turin, the cloth remained. 5, the garden tomb believed to be the location. So I give you a fun pictures to go with this. I think it's fun. So I want us to read out of, I didn't put it in here. I'm sorry. I'll just read it. The next day is that after the day of preparation, the chief priests and the Pharisees gathered before Pilate and said, "Sir, we remember how that impostor said, 'While he is still alive, after 3 days I will rise.' Therefore, order the tomb to be made secure until the third day, lest his disciples go and steal him away and tell the people he has risen from the dead. And the last fraud will be the worse than the first." Pilate said to them, "You have a guard of soldiers. Go make it as secure as you can." So they went and made the tomb secure. Now after the Sabbath, toward the dawn of the first day, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to the tomb. And behold, there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord descended from heaven and came and rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like lightning, his clothing white as snow. And for fear of him, the guards trembled and became like dead men. But the angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, for he has risen, and as he said, come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell the disciples that he has risen from the dead, and behold, he is going before you to Galilee. There you will see him. See, I have told you." So they departed quickly from the tomb with fear and great joy and ran to tell his disciples. And behold, Jesus met them and said, "Greetings." And they came and took hold of his feet and worshipped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers to go to Galilee, and there they will see me." So while they were going, behold, some of the guards went into the city and told the chief priests all what had taken place. And when they had assembled with the elders and taken counsel, they gave sufficient sum of money to the soldiers and said to tell the people, "His disciples came by night and stole him away while we were asleep. And if this comes to governor's ears, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble. So they took the money and did as they were directed. And this story has been spread among the Jews to this day. So Roman guards were actually stationed to roll a large stone, more likely a circular stone, completely to cover the entrance. So that's something to take in value. It would take a lot of people to move that stone. It wouldn't be something you could just come through the night and just push it away. It would make some noise. Another thing to think about, Roman soldiers had a vow of their life if any person entered that grave, stealing the body, and then stating that he, Jesus, rose again. These soldiers were very accountable. So the Roman culture was, you had a duty. Let's say, who served in the military? Maybe this is a better way of putting this. Has anybody served in the military here? Very good. So you know, if you're posted somewhere, if you leave that site, you would be either AWOL or you'd be against orders, right? And you would suffer severe punishment, usually. My brother served, so that's why I kind of know that. But Roman soldiers had it worse, where it would be a life sentence. If you walked away, you were a defector. You actually stepped away from the Roman, and they would actually say you could be scourged and crucified yourself. So it was that serious of a thing. So these guys were actually scared for their own lives when they went to the Pharisees and the elders and said, "Hey, this happened." And the elders said, "Well, let's concoct something so it doesn't so far-fetched." Because really, if you look at this, it's very supernatural. Because most people aren't going to believe that an angel came down, rolled the stone away, and sat on it. And that it looked like, you know, shining outward. So the soldiers had no idea how to take this, other than, well, this guy just showed up and he could push a stone away. I find that really amazing that really we see a conspiracy really started that still permeates the Jewish culture today. That they still struggle and say, you know what, a guy was probably stolen. If you talk to a lot of the theologians over there, they would say the body was stolen from the disciples so that they could make up this story. So, this is an interesting thing. So you would think if you really wanted to concoct a really good story, you would pick your best witnesses, wouldn't you? Your strongest witnesses in that time frame. So sadly, women were more of a second-handed witness because they had dealt with a lot of gossip in that culture. And sadly, women were not seen in the greatest sense of being witnesses. But yet, if you're writing down scripture, this is something I find interesting. Why would you put your strongest testimony into what happened? If I was writing a story, I'll put it in this view. If I was writing a story, I would pick the greatest source that I could find. And instead, they picked something that showed that they were, it was really a more embarrassing thing, yet it was the truth. The Holy Spirit had them record it, that it was Mary and other women that saw the empty tomb first, and that they were witnesses of it. I find that really interesting. So their motive was actually to use the spices and oils so that the decaying body of Jesus would not smell of decay. Common practice for the buried bodies at that time. They didn't want you walking by a grave and go, whoa, what's that smell? You know, they really wanted the body prepared. It was very much, I think it came out with the Egyptians as well as the Jewish people, that they would take care of the body. They would try to preserve the body as well as to make sure that it's not going to smell the whole place up. You're not gonna walk by the grave and go, oh, what is it? Like, oh, you know. So I really found that interesting that just like Mary or a woman came to Jesus at one point and anointed his feet with her tears and with a very good and expensive oil that was actually used for burial. So it's even a encouragement that was happening even there. And here's another thing that I find really interesting. You don't see Jesus appear to the disciples who went there. Jesus actually appeared to Mary. Jesus chose to present himself to Mary at the tomb, giving encouragement and instruction for his disciples. He used her because of her passion. And this is how I would say it, he knew the disciples would have a hard time believing it, and yet he was like, I want you to be the first one to really testify of my resurrection, myself being risen up. So we see again, Peter and John. It says, after hearing from the women, Peter and John ran to the tomb to confirm what was said was true. I threw this in because I thought it was really interesting. So this actually came out of John 23 through 10. So it says, so Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going towards the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying on the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths, but folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went in, and he saw and believed. And for as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead, then the disciples went back to their homes. So this is what I find interesting, and this is part of my, I like to see passion. I like to see competition. I think all of us like competition, wouldn't you say? We don't just stop and say, oh, you run ahead. It's we like to race each other. We like to try to do better. And I think there's a godly passion for that if we use it correctly. But I think this is interesting that they were being so boyish that they were racing each other to the tomb. And John made it very obvious. Hey, guess what? I won. And here's another interesting thing. If you look throughout the scriptures, especially the Gospel of John, you'll see other cases of that. Peter and John loved to race each other because Peter was the strong one. And John always referred to himself as the disciple whom Jesus loved. And as much as we can be like, oh, you know, that's a prideful saying, I think he understood his relationship with Christ so much better than some of us even do, even myself, of calling ourselves the disciples whom he loved, the people who followed him, who he loved. All right, the Shroud of Turin. Who has heard of the Shroud of Turin? Heard of it. Why is it called the Shroud of Turin? So Turin is actually where they had displayed it. So it's actually the city that they actually did a lot of research as well as displayed it for the people. And that's where it got its name, the Shroud of Turin. Now, the great debate is whether this is a true object that depicts a crucified man. And I'll say many believers believe that this is authentic. There are people that say it's not, and they've tried to do carbon dating and stuff like that. I struggle with carbon dating because you have to have an equilibrium for it to be accurate. So the decay actually is very horrible. Why do you guys think the cloth is imprinted? I'm gonna try to hide one of them. Do you guys have any? Why do you think that it is imprinted that it looks like a man on there? All right, so there has been a lot of studies done on this cloth to try to figure out why there's an impression on it and why, if you look, I don't know if you can see in these pictures, but a lot of research actually shows that this person had all the makings of a crucifixion. On his wrist, he has the wounds. On his ankles, you won't be able to see those. He has the scarring. On his head, there is a markings that would show wounds. So this has been really studied for a while, and it's really a question if this possibly could be the linen cloth that was covering Jesus Christ. I'm not saying it is. I'm not saying it isn't. I kind of lean towards, as I said, there is some skepticism, but I kind of lean towards it a little bit more. And the reason why the impression is there, they found, is from a great flash of light. So a flash of light, especially a great flash of light on cloth, will actually imprint it. So the reason why that's there is there was a great flash happening, at which point that was actually recorded on the cloth. That was imprinted on the cloth. So my question is, there's moments in Jesus' life that he actually showed the disciples, Mount of Transfiguration. They said that he had a great light expressed off him, so much so that the disciples fell on their hands and knees and worshiped. And even Peter said, can I just make you an altar up here? Like, let's just make this a temple spot right here. Let's just have a worship right here. And I think the resurrection power, there had to have been light expressed out of the body, which I know sounds strange, but even Jesus said, I am the light of the world. You'd say that's expressive, but I think as much as that it's an expressive term, I believe that he had the light that was able to come out of him. Here's something to think about. Revelation 22:5. It says, and night will be no more. There will be no need for a light or a lamp or sun, for the Lord God will be their light, and they will reign forever and ever. Yeah. Yes. Correct. Right. So that's part of the challenge. And if you can see, the face is actually less expressive than the rest of the body. There's a little more of a faded coloring, again, veiled, like you said. So the face covering was on. I'm not, once again, I'm being very careful to say, I'm not saying it's true, I'm not saying it's false, but what I'm seeing is there are indications that it could be true, and there's things that you could question about it. I just found it as an interesting fact. Yes. Mm-hmm. Correct. Exactly. And we're going to get to another slide here. It's called the Garden Tomb. But there are two tombs. One is in a cathedral, a large cathedral that they believe is the body, the location where Jesus was laid. And they actually have it protected with this cathedral so that nobody can get in, nobody can get out without their permission. The Garden Tomb is actually a little more presentable and allowing people to actually enter and see this grave that could very possibly be, once again, a place where Jesus was laid. So let's go there. So a Garden Tomb, a place believed to be the site of Jesus' burial, the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. Many Christians and others have visited the site, hosting worship concerts, sitting in awe of such a place. So once again, like you stated, it's very easy for us to get so enraptured that we're like, this is the place. And we have to be careful with that. Keep your skepticism up, but at the same point, even if it's not the same place, it's kind of what I would say is it's similar to Christmas. Is we look at Christmas and we go, oh, you know, that's when Jesus was born. We don't know the actual date. We pick that as what we would say is the date of a time to worship the birth of Christ because it's a time of giving. And I would say the same for this, that there are very big indications that this is the location, but I'm not going to say yes or no. I would say leave that to you to pursue that truth and that revelation by Christ. But I like to have a place where I can think about maybe he did lay here. Maybe he did rise here. Maybe I can consider the goodness of his resurrection. So once again, I believe that this is a good or great chance of being the tomb that Jesus laid in. My view, again, not saying yes or no on that. So what I would say is take heart. The evidences are a lot better, actually, that there was a resurrection than there was not. If you asked any historian today, in this day and age, they would actually say that Jesus lived and that he was crucified and that there is indications that he did rise again. And what we're going to step into next is his appearances to his disciples and how even historians record him being present in the after the resurrection. So I have a couple of videos real quick. This is from the garden tomb.
Here in Jerusalem, just outside the old city walls, you can find a beautiful and vibrant garden. And right beside the garden, a rock face known as Skull Hill, or Golgotha. Welcome to the garden tomb. Scripture tells us that in the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb. It was into that tomb that the body of Jesus was laid. Millions of people around the world believe that this garden is that place. What makes a visit to the garden tomb unique is the connection between Skull Hill, the garden, and the tomb itself. These three elements work together to bring to life that final chapter of Jesus' ministry. Early on the third day after the burial of Jesus, some women came to the tomb seeking his body. An angel appeared to them and said, "I know that you seek Jesus who was crucified. He is not here, he is risen." This is a tomb, an empty tomb that speaks of the power of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. For many people, this is a life-changing moment. After a visit to the tomb, there is time and space for people to reflect upon the story of Jesus the Messiah, his death and resurrection. Many groups decide to book a place where they can meet for worship and prayer, maybe communion. As well as tours of the garden, we also host events such as worship services for large Christian groups and also musical concerts. Every day, groups and individuals from all over the world are blessed and encouraged by their visit to the garden tomb. Entrance is free, and we're supported by the donations of our visitors and also by the garden tomb shop. Whoever you are and wherever you come from, I encourage you to come and visit the garden tomb. Come and see for yourself. We look forward to welcoming you soon.
What is the power that can bring death to life? How can the darkness ever turn to light? How can a shattered heart be whole again? And the dream you thought was over suddenly begin. That's the power of an empty tomb. That's the miracle that love can do. Broken lives are mended just like new. That's the power of an empty tomb. That's the power. Desperate world today. Where is our refuge when we feel so afraid? How can the lost be found and taken in? For there'll be no condemnation waiting there for them. That's the power of an empty tomb. That's the miracle that love can do. Broken lives are mended just like new. That's the power of an empty tomb. Oh, that's the power of an empty tomb. There are no chains to bind us anymore.
That's the power of an empty tomb. That's the